in my country, we had tribal problems because there are only two different tribes, whereby if you're on the opposition tribe, you'll be in trouble. That's why most of the people on the opposition side have fled to go to the neighboring countries like Congo, Uganda, Tanzania, Kenya. Yeah, so I had no option, I had to run away.
Before I was in prison with a group of Algerians. So immigration, we say, held us to study our cases. That's why I had a bit complicated case. That's why I spent a long time in detention.
Yeah, when I came to this country, I went straight to the Home Office and I explained my situation, so everything was moving fine. Temporarily leave to stay in this country, and eventually I was arrested in 2004 and detained me.
I thought a lot about it and researched on the website, spoke to a couple of other students at the university who were studying as well, studying law, and I thought it would be quite a good idea.
I didn't really want to be involved in a campaigning role, but I wanted to do something that would support individuals, and it seemed just the right thing. It was local, it was something very, very specific where you could help an individual.
In detention, life is like in prison because you are not free. That means you can do nothing. And when you are not free, you have depression, you have stress. You don't feel normal. So it's a hard life, not very, very nice, not very good.
I've been told to expect a prison-like environment, but I'd never been in a prison. And I really was quite surprised at how emotional it made me feel. And just feeling vulnerable, being made to feel vulnerable by that. But of course, then you think, well, I'm going to be able to go home again afterwards. So you go in, and all the time you're thinking of the difference between you and the people who can't leave.
The first time when I was told about the detention centre, I had an image of it in my mind. I thought that it would be something similar to a prison, because I'd been told already by both my university teacher and the staff here at the DDVG. And after, when I came out of there, I was so surprised because everybody was so nice. Like, the staff there were really helpful, like all the officers and stuff were really nice. The actual detainees themselves were really friendly, and everybody seemed like really happy to see us.
I assume that volunteers feeling guilty when they leave the removal center and they say, oh my God, I haven't changed his situation. But just by volunteering and visiting an immigration detainees, they have changed the world. And I constantly say that volunteers change the world because they have changed an individual's perception about this country, about these people.
Yes, I do feel guilty. I feel awful thinking about people being left behind there. And sometimes I think I'd like to do more, but there isn't really more that you can do. So you go in, you do what you can, you phone up in between visits, you make sure that they're not, you know, your detainee knows when you're coming, knows when to expect you, knows when you can't come, and that's as much as you can do.
Sometimes I do feel guilty going up there and then thinking to myself that I can walk away when they have to stay there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
The moment they bring in detention, the first 2 weeks is very difficult, because in the first 2 weeks you get too much pressure, like you want to kill yourself, you think that's the end of the world, and you know. When you get this, like, visitor group, Dover people came, you get a visitor who comes in, they talk to you and you chat, so you tend to calm down, and all what you're thinking can really change.
Well, I think you go into a big room, a kind of conference room where you sit at a table, the detainee comes and sits with you, and you make conversation. It sounds difficult because perhaps there's a language problem, perhaps there isn't, and you've never met this person before, but it's amazing how easy it is to make conversation. You just take an interest in the other person as a human being with whatever experiences, whatever things they have. It's just becoming their friend. I mean, I've written letters for them to the Home Office. I've talked to my MP. It's not essential to do any of those things. It's just what you feel moved to do. I think the basic thing is being a reliable friend who will come at a fixed time.
I didn't realise until I actually started visiting that it was more of an emotional sort of thing, because originally in my mind I thought that it would be more, I'm going to give them cards, if they need something, I'm going to contact solicitors and things like that. But I didn't realise actually how close friends, like having that sort of contact with somebody, somebody who is quite vulnerable and somebody who's like doesn't have maybe friends or family in the country, how much of an input my just being there, without regardless of helping them, without phoning solicitors or doing anything, just the fact that I would visit them and sit with them for an hour, 2 hours, just how much support that I could offer just being with them.
It relaxes you, you know what I mean? It gives you, hope that you have friends, that they listen to you, you listen to them. If you have any problem, you tell them. If they can't help, they help, of course. So you feel that you have support. You are not alone.
Overall, in general, I think the organisation is very beneficial to us as volunteers, and I think it's very beneficial, obviously, to the detainees. Everybody that works here works really hard, and it's really like a team. Everybody's friends here. It's not just like people come to work for a job. They're here because they actually enjoy what they're doing, and they know that they're giving something back to the community.
Every time I've needed help, the staff have been incredibly supportive.
We provide induction for our volunteers, DVD nights, support meetings, basic listening skills training, diversity training, human rights training, and other important training like immigration training regarding immigration and asylum.
The organisation is very supportive. If ever I had a problem or a doubt, then I could just speak to anybody. They would be there to help me. The support meetings were very good because I had a chance to sit down and explain my case with some of the other volunteers and some of the other staff here. And if there was anything that I had to question about what I could do or what my detainee could do or could ask me, for example, then all the support was there and everything that I needed was in my face.
Yeah, there was really a big change. Yeah, because when I was, before I had a visitor, really I didn't like to talk to anyone outside because I thought, oh my God, what am I going through? And most of the time I used to stay in my room and I'm sleeping and I'm thinking. I didn't want to go to the gym, I didn't want to go to the mosque, I didn't want to go anywhere. But after I got in touch with the visitor, and I got a visitor who used to come to see me, she was really a good lady, and we went on together. She tried to call me all the time, give me all the assistance I needed, and she used to give me good lectures. You don't have to hurt yourself, you have to keep your spirits high, you'll be released one day. And it worked out very well, really. Yeah, so like a visitor group in detention is very, really important for a change, someone's life in there.